What in the fuck is going on?
And now, welcome to the show. It's the all-new Rollout Show.
Roll out.
With new sound effects, new graphics.
Right. I just want to let y'all know.
I thought I was at the movie.
It is the all-new Rollout Show right here at Morris Media Studios. We're live on a Wednesday. Go to speedyandfriends.net. Watch and listen to all this shit. But y'all don't understand. Poetess with no dick is a genius.
Yes.
She is sharing jobs right now.
Getting stuff all through the night.
She turned Jamaican all of a sudden. She got six jobs. She's multitasking.
She has invented the new wheel.
Right.
You want coffee? Want me press play? You want me make sound effects?
I'm at the tail dishes. He got to give us another week because we need this add-on for this motherfucking...
I built a new roof for the studio.
I do things. What thing you talk about, Jack?
Hilarious.
Poetess, apparently, dickless in Poetess Town is the work efficiency. It's incredible. Now, this one next to me don't get no dick and shut completely down.
Yeah, I'm all
short,
off.
She's supposed to
write down her segment. Nigga, a four-year-old wrote this shit.
I know, I'm all disheveled.
Yeah, she's like, who's Johnny? It goes bad.
Short circuit. You need dick to operate it. That one over there just needs to stay dickless. And you keep dick out your life, you function. You don't get high. You don't do nothing. Well, I guess you'd be puffing on it.
Welcome to the White House, President Poetess. Hasn't been laid in 20 years, but she gets shit done.
Show your love for Poetess.
Yeah. Poetess. The Poetess.
And please, if you guys haven't seen our opening, it's incredible.
I just played it.
Oh, you did?
I know
you did.
Oh,
is that what you had played?
Somebody in the chat room said it wasn't shit.
We're such assholes.
That must be dishes. He ain't getting that.
Your effects ain't shit.
Yeah, he like the fact you were efficient, bitch.
I got my Timberlands on.
What is it about haters? It's usually one or two that speak for everybody.
I don't like this segment.
Yeah.
I'm like, and it ain't for you then. Don't listen.
We ain't bought a motherfucker on the show yet they like. Mm-mm. I don't like that.
Right.
Who the fuck are you, nigga?
But opinions ain't shit. Everybody has one.
Especially these.
But no, they tune in every week. Uh-huh.
I hate your fucking show.
Right.
What time it come on?
Is it on time?
I hope the next show Mo ain't shit.
Who? He said, I hope the next show is more ancient.
I don't get it.
It's worse. I hope the next show is worse. But I was doing a terrible person hiding behind a computer that ain't shit, that really can't even talk.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. Oh,
anyway, it's the Rollout Show. It's your boy Speedy.
Wake up, Speedy.
I'm your boy Speedy.
I'm the Poetess.
And Nikki Pam.
And I'm RT, the white boy, the most ignorant with the least pigment.
On time.
I love when you say that.
Well, I was early. It was like there was no traffic. It's Yom Kippur and there's no Jewish people.
Oh, that was cool.
Happy Shaka Khan to all my Jewish friends out there. But yeah, so there was nobody on the highway.
What you trying to say?
I'm trying to say Jews cause traffic jams. That's what I'm trying to say.
Let's make sure we get it. You are German?
No.
Of descent?
I'm part German.
Which part?
Which part?
The hates Jews part. No,
we don't hate Jews.
No, I'm
you won't be no, back here.
No, right.
No, I'm teasing. But it is it's Yom Kippur, and I guess I don't know. People were taking the day off or something.
Well, there's no
traffic.
School.
Jews don't work on this day, right?
I think that's what it is.
School days,
and they don't drive either, work or drive.
Yeah, it's Sabbath.
It's the Sabbath, I guess.
Yes.
Something's going on. No traffic, motherfucker.
Clean it up, motherfucker. You are in shit.
Well,
you're in shit Kapoor.
Well, you know what? We are starting an hour later now.
Mm-hmm.
And yes, Speedy was telling me, I'm so glad I thought of the new time. He was whining about changing the time.
I don't do change well. Once I get into a groove, I don't want to change. Like, I go to, that's why police ask you, black people, where you go get your haircuts. I just do shit the same all the time. I go to the barbershop on Friday. I can't go on Thursday or Wednesday.
Oh,
I have to go on Friday. I shave on
Friday.
Are you
autistic?
Yes. Let me tell you, I bought him some oatmeal this morning with fruit on it. You would have thought...
They put fruit on my shit last week. I didn't ask for this.
Thank you.
They took it every time.
And they blended it in. I couldn't even get the shit out.
I saw oatmeal. They asked for like, fruit salad.
Yeah, I got fruit and a little bit of oat.
I was like,
yeah, what kind of meal is this?
This motherfucker next to me like, just eat it, nigga. really? That's where we at? Get and you then, some no, dick.
It
How
was
about
the whole thing about throwing it away. And I didn't want to put it like in fruit. The new trash can.
Only Chris like, understood. Really? She said, Speedy, you want me to go get you now? I was like, it's okay.
But the funny thing was, then he was like, the raisins are good.
Yeah, the raisins are okay. I couldn't get them all out.
Fuck these apples, but the raisins are delicious.
Ain't that a bitch? Now,
but these salty nuts are delicious.
So yesterday, I truly believe, and I think somebody make a meme of it. You need a poetess button. Everyone needs a poetess button or switch in your life.
What does that mean?
A motherfucker calls me three times. And each time, it's a lady. She go, hello, someone give me your number? You have good food? I said, no, they gave you the wrong number, babe. She said, why you call me babe? I want food. I said, okay. I told you I had the wrong number. So, and I'm being polite, but all of a sudden a switch went off my head and said, what would poetess do? And I finally went to my poetess mood. I went, say, bitch, don't call here no motherfucking money. And I hung up. But
this
like,
phone call's over.
For 10 minutes, I'm trying to tell her, no, you have the wrong number. My name is Speedy. And she's like, no. Someone gave me your number on a piece of paper. They say you have good food. I don't have food here. Why don't you have food here? Bitch, I just snapped and went into my poetess mode.
Oh my god.
So
goodness.
I think we all need a poetess button.
Yeah, what would poetess do?
What would poetess do? Which
I'm actually pretty patient.
No, P. She'd have called you and
until
said,
shit hits the fan.
We're all looking at you like,
what would
really?
You say, Pat? Seriously, P. You would have went.
How many times did she call you?
Well, I hung up on her first. Well, I didn't hang up, but I saw a number I didn't know, and then I answered it and I said yes, and then she was like.
And then she probably was like, hello, because Speedy has one of those trick voicemails.
I hate calling Speedy.
Oh, it'd be so like, annoying. Hello, speak up. Hey, Speedy, every time.
And we fall
every time.
For,
I know, that's the worst shit.
And when like, motherfuckers call me back, they go, Speedy. Hey, what's up? Okay, nigga.
Is this you?
That's the worst.
Yeah, so she probably was thrown off because of your voicemail.
Yeah, but
there
was nobody I knew. I didn't know her. And she wouldn't get off the phone. I was like, and then I hit her with the look. I was trying to be nice. I said, look here, sweetheart. Why you call me sweetheart? I am not your sweetheart. I just want food. I said, that's when my poetess button
look,
kicked
man.
In.
Uh-huh.
Say, bitch. And I hung up.
This because conversation
I was trying to be
with.
Nice. But the whole time I'm going, I should hit my poetess button a little earlier. I spent 10 minutes of my motherfucking life. I can't get back. I needed you then.
Can you
be more in my life?
I think I'm in your life enough, Speedy.
Yeah. So I've been told.
3 days a week.
So I've been told.
By who?
Oh, let's move on.
Oh, wait, no. No,
let's not move on.
We don't want to say the sponsor of that.
She didn't give
Come
me
on,
the...
Nikki Pam, what you know?
I don't know.
He don't tell me stuff about that.
Because I know Pam can't hold water. Pam do like this. I say, Pam, don't tell nobody. Okay, what do you want me to tell? I ain't told you yet. Oh, okay. Go, tell me now. Tell me. I can't listen. No way. Really? Hold on. I got to make a call. Bitch, I just said don't tell nobody.
I'd like to hear what Pam has to say.
I don't know anything. He won't tell us that part, the hateration part.
Mm-hmm.
Who hates? Nobody hates on you guys.
Bullshit.
No.
Bullshit.
I just spend too much time here.
Oh.
No, I don't.
What the hell?
I can't do it. No, everything's good.
Speedy's got a curfew.
Speedy is not apparently. You're not back by 3.
I'm back by sundown, Speedy.
It's something about being married, nigga. You can't just leave the house. I had to have a reason.
That's exactly why I don't want to be married.
I know.
I like to come and go as I please.
But throw shit away on purpose, like throw all the ice away and be like, we got to go get ice. I got to go get ice. I'll be back in 3 days.
But honey, we have 5 trays full in a refrigerator.
I don't like that kind of
ice. I threw that shit out. I mean, it melted.
Yeah, that ice got raisins in it.
It's fruit and ice. I hate that.
Fruit and ice. No, it's just that when you marry, once you home, nigga, you might as well put a padlock on that motherfucker because all I do is look out the window. Go ahead.
Now fill out your permission slip before you go on the field trip. You need a chaperone? No.
Like I had, because we have to park on the street. I have a garage, but can't get the fucking big ass truck and the car.
No,
because you have all that furniture.
Watch
in
your
there.
Tone. So anyway, so I have to park on the street. So I'm parking, trying to find somewhere to park. I get a phone call. Where are you? I said, I'm at home. Where are you at home? I'm in the house. I said, I'm parking the car.
I'm in the garage with the engine running with the door closed.
If you give me a minute, I'll leave.
This world.
Being married is different. Like, nigga, the lady we had here Monday.
Who?
The
white girl?
Yeah. So she texts me at 2 a.m. I looked at my phone like, shit, I ain't answering that motherfucker.
But I looked at her like, imagine she texted you.
Yeah, we were asleep.
I just think wedding vows go a little too far sometimes. Like, they're just too unrealistic. Like, do you promise to love and to hold till death do you part? You're like, that's a long fucking time. That's a lot of pressure, motherfucker.
Unless you meet them and they already on their deathbed.
Well, this is how it should be. Like, you would definitely get married if it was, do you promise to love and to hold until you get tired of this shit? You're like, I can definitely do that. Yeah, until I get tired of it. Yeah, that sounds great.
I'm out.
The pressure's off.
Artie, are you ever going to get married?
No.
No. Not till I'm maybe.
God.
Well, no. I mean, I might get married when
not
I'm
not till he needs his diaper change.
Exactly. Thank you. I need some medical attention.
Here's his.
Change my catheter.
This is RT's dilemma. He's only going to marry a sister.
We know
so
that.
How he going to get her back to Georgia in front of all them steckles? All right. Now, who you marrying here, RT? Richard, right. Who the hell you got here?
Is that the help?
Yeah,
tell her I want some iced tea. Tell her I want some sweet tea. Make some sweet tea. That's my wife.
Well, okay. Tell your wife get sweet tea. What the fuck are you doing, right? Hey, man, be proactive. Get this bitch working.
Tell your wife to get the sweet tea then.
So you have to wait till your family dies off and then you get married.
Yeah, wait till death do them part.
Do them part, right?
The youngest cousins left. Yeah. Like, finally accept
more
racial.
Progressive family
more
member.
Progressive.
Yeah. Okay, well, let's ask the question. Do you guys think monogamy is natural?
No,
or do you think it's a
choice?
No,
I always win in monogamy.
What? In Monopoly?
Oh, yeah.
You say Monopoly, you stupid.
No, I got a mahogany,
You like mahogany sisters.
I got a monogamy dresser.
Yeah, are you?
No, look, I don't know, man. I mean, I think yes, if you meet the right person, I'm sure it's possible.
No, we're talking about you, brother.
Oh, talking about me?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought we were just talking about...
He's speaking for himself. For that's
society.
What he thinks of it.
But yeah,
so you're saying, RT, if you met the right woman that was real cool and
big old ass.
You'd be willing
hilarious.
To
money.
Just be
real
only
hair.
With her.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying.
That counts you out,
man. That's going to be tough.
Yeah, I know, right?
That's a tough one there.
Mixed with Indian.
RT.
Navajo.
Hysterical.
So, RT, you're saying if you met the right girl, you would be willing to be monogamous.
Yeah, but you know, being monogamous, I said it's like, you know, they say it's possible, but I've also been told there are ghosts, but I haven't seen one. And UFOs.
So you said you could be with it, but if you see some other pieces.
Put it this way, I have to be with a really understanding woman. She'd have to understand.
That you're going to fuck around?
What's the one on Love & Hip Hop last night?
I want to be left alone sometimes, too.
With all the tattoos I can't.
I want to be left alone. Hey.
You know what I mean?
I feel you.
Like, where are you going? Away from you. Just for, like, an hour or two or three, and I'll be back.
Poetess?
Do I believe in, like, for women, they say it's easier, of course. But I know men that are monogamous.
Mm-hmm.
No, you don't.
You know,
my
yes,
daddy.
You do.
Your dad was monogamous?
Mm-hmm.
He is now. He's 97 years old.
Yeah,
he's been off the market for a minute.
Never cheated on my mom.
No.
I ain't going to say never. We don't know.
Do you think he would tell you?
Where daddy's penis has been.
Do you think he would tell you, though?
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, that's
you know
thing.
I fucked some bitches before I met your mom. Your mom was in the hospital. I fucked a gang of bitches.
And there was one time I went out of town 20 years ago.
We have a call, though. Caller, what's your name and where you calling
daddy.
From? I know, right?
Caller.
Hey, caller, what's your name and where you calling from? Sounds like he dropped.
Yeah,
but we'll
fuck
just
you.
Call back, caller.
Hater. Anyway, Pam, you believe your daddy ain't do nothing?
Yes, I do. But I do. Okay, here's the thing. When it comes to monogamy, I live by the hope factor. I hope that it can happen.
Here's the problem.
Oh, Speedy, don't try to crush my dreams as usual.
That's what I'm here for.
I don't know. He always says it.
When it comes to men,
I hate you.
Especially if you got it going on. Let's say if you just an average, nice-looking guy, whatever that looks like,
mm-hmm.
and you got a cool job, nice car,
mm-hmm.
he got at least 4 or 5 bitches he can pick from.
I don't
On a regular.
That.
He got 4 or 5 bitches
saying,
that want to fuck
most
him.
Of the great men you've ever read about in the history books all cheated.
Yeah.
Everybody.
And
Martin
those
Luther
are,
King,
and those
JFK,
are men in power.
Gandhi. Gandhi fucked around.
And you know
Gandhi?
I'm just saying everybody. George Washington.
Well, we know he did. He didn't
George
know.
Thomas Jefferson, we know he did.
No, they fucked up. Yeah, all them Washingtons in this world.
But I'm just saying,
right. Pam.
We have a call, you guys.
Okay. Again? Caller, what's your name and where you calling from?
Hey, it's Martini calling from ATL. How are you guys doing?
Hi, Martini.
Hey, Martini.
What it do, baby?
Speedy, happy belated birthday.
How you doing, baby? Thank you.
You
so very much.
I like Speedy.
Why did you get the bass all of a sudden appear in your voice?
Speedy, you just think you so sexy.
Don't he?
I think you are, too.
I got a little something. I got a little something for you.
I feel sorry for you. I want to cry for you, and I'm hearing this story. You make me think that you're sitting in a window with a bib on, slobbering, wishing you could come out and play.
Yeah,
you miss that single life, don't you?
I don't miss a single life. I miss the come and going.
You miss
like,
the
just
fucking.
Get up and go. Yeah. And go. Cause I have
and
to,
that's called being single.
Mm-hmm.
No, I could.
Oh, a shoe sale.
Yeah, I just.
You know, I just want to go.
Like when I buy shoes now, I got to kind of ease them into my closet. I got about 50 pair of brand new sneakers.
You do Mission
in the garage.
Impossible. Bum,
I can't bum, just bring bum, them bum, in because why are you in the mall buying shoes? And nah, nah, nah. I'm like, bitch, all this shit paid. I could buy shoes.
Okay, do you buy her shoes?
Good question.
I don't really don't want to talk to you right now.
We're breaking up with you. Yeah, we're losing you. We're breaking up.
Your signal. Apparently,
I'm sorry. I'm just asking. I thought maybe if you start buying her shoes, when you buy you some, she might start letting you bring a little bit more now.
Well, he does. He lays away. He gets the left one,
is
and
this,
then he comes
is
back.
Is this a talk to Speedy moment? What the fuck is that?
I think Speedy's still adjusting. It's almost like a culture shock.
No, I buy her. I don't buy her shoes like
that. Thanks for the call, Martini.
No, no.
Thank you,
Martini.
You guys
have a good... And I'm working on that, I think.
So what did it say? The first...
48?
Yeah. No, the first year is... The first
48.
Huh?
The first year is the hardest, and then you have the seven-year itch. So you go. It goes through ups and downs.
I mean, I'm not saying anything wrong. I just feel like... Like, I'm used to just, now I got to say, hey, you know, I'm going to the gym. Or if she
So you're
said,
saying you have to lie now? I'm sorry. But, dude, I feel you. It's like, you can't, like, permission slips. You got to get permission slips.
Mm-hmm.
And you got to give.
All the time.
And you have to give your
reasoning.
And you have to give your whereabouts.
Whereabouts and logic.
Yeah.
And
this new thing was, so what you do there? I was like, I ain't do shit. Then she go, well, where's bags? I went to the store. You want to know I went to the store? Let me tell me.
Exact details.
Yeah. So I'm walking in the mall, right?
I woke up. I took a shit.
Yeah. So I got to get my, what's the rapper? Wake up in the morning, get out of bed.
Soulja Boy. You have your checklist.
Soulja Boy.
Yeah, Soulja Boy.
Remember on Love and Hip Hop, whatever it is, Hollywood, Soulja Boy said that he was with the girl, that's his main boo, and she just knows what it is. And then she even confirmed the last episode that
again,
she knows he fucks other people.
Ladies, understand
that.
Dude's got, your daddy has somebody else. Trust
my
me.
My daddy did not. Mm-mm.
Let's call him.
Call him up.
No. I'll call him. Hey, Pop, check this out. The little bitch
Mr. Morris.
Mr. Morris.
Yeah, let's talk about you.
Slanging at it.
Mr. Morris always keeps, all my life,
side pieces.
My dad has had at least.
Really?
Two or three.
Dad, I was looking at him like, why are you putting your daddy on blast?
He don't listen to the show.
Well, him and my mother broke up when I was a baby, so.
Over those reasons, exactly.
You pregnant.
All right, Bob Marley. Rita Marley knew that he was having babies by other women.
And when a man is in
cool
power, when we got money.
My daddy didn't have no power, so.
So you know he fucking. Imagine if your daddy was like the owner of some shit. He could fuck all the bitches that work for him. Ain't nobody gonna say shit.
Yeah.
You're like, no.
Don't ruin her world. Even if he did, Speedy, don't try to.
Dream crusher.
He's
a dream crusher.
He gets off the
screen. Right.
Wait till you go to your daddy house tomorrow and be like,
Speedy said.
Pam, your dad was a good man. He was a good Christian, faithful man.
Yes, he was.
He did not sleep around.
He would never.
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 I mean, why would you?
He's got a great thing at home. They all fuck around.
No
I don't
reason.
Fuck around. I don't fuck around.
Because
I don't want to take that L.
What's your biggest fear of if you cheated?
Losing everything?
Because it ain't like
no,
you got
shit.
Like you can pay alimony.
Oh.
Did you sign a prenup?
Paul, this is awful. This kills me. But answer the question.
You get half the couch.
You get the pillows, I get the sheets. How about I ain't got prenup money.
Oh, okay. I get the spare tire, goddammit.
Nigga, we leave what you came with. I'm getting my tennis shoes. You get the best.
That's real shit. That's funny.
I bought everything in the house, nigga.
That's good. You bought everything in the house?
Everything.
Oh, okay. I know everything. One thing, because I came over to Speedy's house. I know he bought the TV. I know that.
It's a big old TV
in there?
It's
a big fucking TV in the living room.
Let's you can
turn the TV.
Damn, there you go.
You can change the channel with your feet. So the TV is bigger than the room.
Ain't that a bitch?
It's a 45-incher, huh? It's a 45-inch TV?
You got 37-inch. Remember 37 inches was huge?
Yeah, and now they're just movie screen. It's ridiculous.
I know. The average TV size was 25 inches, actually.
And this is how fucked up jaded we are as people. You go to somebody's house and they got a 30-inch. You're like, oh, this nigga broke?
I know, right? It's true. You are
I know. I have
TV.
A 47-inch.
I have a 55.
And this is how you really get jaded. Your shit ain't mounted?
What? Really?
I just got rid of my 37-inch. I got a flat screen now, but I got rid of the 37-inch fat back, the big booty back.
Yes. TV.
Dude, this thing weighs 300 pounds.
True that.
My TV got back. This motherfucker got.
He had the TV fat. With the tube.
No, so, it's the fat back.
Again,
it's
like we are jaded as people. Breaker. I go to my boy house. I think I told you to watch the fight.
You did.
This nigga got the bubble back TV. I came in. Everybody sitting around like we had the fucking. I was like. I could have watched this at my house.
All right, we're going to move this to the living room. I need six people, six young, strong men.
And then, you know, the big box TVs back in the day,
yes.
The big.
When I bought my first one, I was come off tour, and I bought the big screen TV. Nigga, I thought I was doing some shit
because
you put your VCR on top. You put all your trophies from when you was in high school, your pictures. And I came home, and I said that. I said, nigga, I have made it.
37 inches. Look at that.
You couldn't tell me shit. Everybody, and it didn't even fit in the living room. Matter of fact, you had to walk around this motherfucker to get to the couch.
Like, yeah, it was the couch. Yeah, sit on the TV, man. You
watch the couch, nigga. They said, can you push it back to the wall? It's in the wall, nigga.
Cut a hole in the wall. The neighbors are pissed.
So how big is your TV in your living room, Speedy?
80.
What?
And upstairs is, my room is 70.
God.
Yeah, all the kids got.
You got a panorama TV.
All the kids got 3 inches. It's all y'all need.
They got monitors.
80-inch TV, Speedy. Really? I didn't know they made them that big.
Yeah, that's what she said.
But I said, I'm telling you, the TV is takes up his living.
We are TV stars.
No, it's on. No, it don't,
motherfucker. I'm sure it does.
You got a duck to go in the kitchen.
It's a couch and a TV.
Your television's blocking the door.
It's above the fire.
The TV is the wall, actually.
Yeah, wait till I turn this game on, motherfucker. Yeah. You'd be like, oh,
see,
shit.
When I turn that game on, you like you in the game. Yeah. You're like, motherfucker. This
Caldwell, get in. I'm like, I'm in there.
Yeah, it's in there.
That's the thing about men is that they could have a TV in some crates. They don't care about no couches. They don't care about no...
Yeah. Candles,
just anything, as long as they got a big TV.
If I go a girl, back in the day when I was dating, if I go over a girl house and she ain't have cable,
I gotta break up.
I can't. She's like, "What's wrong?" I said, "Oh no!" So I'm dating this one girl, big titties, light skin, high yellow girl, and and so she hit me with it was Sunday football. She said, "So what you doing Sunday?" I said, "Watching the game." Well, I thought maybe we'd do brunch. Watching the game. She got mad, so I guess she's gonna watch them all. Bitch, I'm gonna watch them games, some hockey, golf. Keep fucking with me.
Right.
I said, I don't go nowhere on Sunday. Don't do that. Well, the fact, why wouldn't you not? I said, I'm at least telling you what I don't do on Sunday. Let's work around that shit.
I don't even go to church. The Lord understands.
She's like, well, can you spend a nice Saturday? No. The other thing, she used to turn
get up early.
She turned her TV off at 9 and put the blindfold thing on.
No,
I went,
no.
I'm in the room like,
and wide awake.
Why the fuck? What's wrong with you? You can't sleep? No.
She's trying to make you go to bed.
What am I, 12?
Come to bed.
But she used to sleep with the
mask.
I don't think I could do that.
The blindfold.
I got to be able to open my eyes.
Yeah, you got
right away.
You wake up. I'm still dead.
And I sleep my house pitch black. Some people everything is off when I go to sleep.
No, I at least have a light on.
I have to have the TV on.
Speedy, you got a night light?
Sleep without the TV.
I'll go to sleep with the TV, but then I'll wake up and turn it off.
I got a glow worm by my pillow.
You got a little glow worm.
That squeeze when I go to the bathroom. I guess. Okay.
It's bright now.
So, Portis, you don't want nothing on?
I like it dark.
What about music playing?
Nothing.
Really?
Sometimes I'll have the TV on, but that goes off at a certain time, too.
Wake up. One time I did wake up, I was out camping at my buddy's place, trimming bud. Anyway, so...
he said trimming bud, threw that in.
Anyway, so, but I don't know if you've ever been, like, you know, way out in the fucking woods, but it's dark as shit.
Yes, it is.
And so I'm in the camper.
I don't know how to bear see.
And I'm in the camper, and it's like exactly 6 feet where I'm sleeping. So I'm I'm crammed in. I got to kind of scooch in a little bit and sleep a little bit. Anyway, I wake up and forgot where the fuck I was at.
Hilarious.
And I tried to push my feet, and I couldn't go nowhere. And then I tried to move my head. I couldn't go nowhere. Uh-huh. And I opened my eyes. I couldn't see shit. I'm like, I'm in a coffin. I'm like, I'm dead. Somebody buried me alive. I'm like, hell.
This ain't funny. This ain't funny, motherfuckers.
Dude, I had to get up, run outside, and fucking look around. And, like, you know, there's, like, little stars up in there. And I'm like, okay, good. I'm just fucking out in the woods. I'm not dead. Nobody buried me alive. All right, that's good.
Not if you got out. Hey, I guess
I've never been camping. Have you?
What?
Yes,
it's just fun.
I hate it. No.
You hate it, Nikki Pam?
No. Ugh.
Because they know.
Bonus, let me ask you something. Campers. If you went camping and you woke up with a condom hanging out of your butt, would you tell anyone?
What?
Would you like to go camping?
What?
It's actually a joke. It's a funny joke. It's a play on words.
Oh, Brokeback Mountain? Yeah, what?
So the question goes, it's a joke. Like, say, do it again, do it again.
Yeah, the joke goes, you ask someone, if you went camping and you woke up in the woods and you woke up with a condom hanging out of your butt, would you tell anyone?
And they would be like, no.
Like, would you like to go camping?
Oh, okay. Oh, my God. Oh, God.
It's just old school. Just
no, you
got to
go camping. You
got
to get away from all your electronics.
Yeah. No, I'd love to go. Let's plan a trip.
I get to see you.
Let's go to Big Bear or something.
Yeah, we go to Big Bear.
Okay, Big Bear.
But we'll get a cabin.
We're
not sleeping in
I can see you in a sleeping bag because you're so little and sleeping bags are so big. It'd just be like, where's she at?
Half of the sleeping bag.
Like a little peel inside the
capsule. Only thing I don't like is bugs. That's the only thing about camping that would bother me.
You gotta pee outside or in a.
That ain't.
You gotta take your pills outside.
Right.
You have to get in the pee. You gotta fuck in the woods.
Speedy, I can't believe you went camping.
Yeah, please, babe. I'm an outdoors motherfucker. You know, especially when I'm trying to get the pussy. Plus, we fucked that in the tent.
Mm.
Yeah, in the woods in nature. Yeah.
Yeah, the bear's like, who?
So Pam, have you gone?
Yes. I used to do it with the Girl Scouts and my family.
No,
about Girl Scouts. She took it back to the Girls.
Damn.
But my family too.
I was 11.
That was 60.
Is that before they integrated? You went camping with all black folks?
I hate both of y'all.
You went to a revival. That's where you didn't go camping. I got it. Yeah, we got to go camping. You got to do that. Call in if you got a camping story.
Yeah. We'll go to Big Bear. That'd be better.
You can't shit in the woods.
In a cabin.
Or if you want to address any of the topics we just mentioned.
Don't shit in the woods, because trust me, them leaves don't work.
Where do you shit?
Yeah, them leaves don't
in
get
a river?
No, you
No,
you shit in the woods, but I'm just saying them leaves take some paper.
Yeah, it takes some paper.
Them leaves don't get
oh,
it.
Oh, you mean to wipe your ass?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
at least bring some toilet paper.
Right. You'll forget. Because you in
forget.
The woods. Nigga, trust me. You'll be like,
oh my God.
Nigga, I know
you a
forgot.
Bear. You big bear. What you got for us, Pete?
The man that started all with the greatest 5 o'clock shadow beard known to man.
Who is that?
We did not know he
George
was gay.
George Michael. Didn't know he was gay.
Oh, it is White Boy Wednesday on the playlist.
That's why RT's here.
That's right.
Ready for the music.
We'll be right back. It's the all new Rollout Show.
Roll
live from Morris Media Studios.
Singing all off beat.
No, he keeps saying chicken wings.
Buffalo wings.
Oh, yeah, buffalo wings. Same thing. It is the all new Rollout Show right here at Morris Media Live Studios. And you can check us out at speedyandfriends.net. That's Speedy, the letter N, friends.net. See us live or whatever.
Oh, or you can see us at morrismedialive.com.
.com.
Whatever.
Morrismedialive.com.
Here it is.
Okay.
It is the all new
POTUS,
World
POTUS.
It is the fantastically all new rollout show.
Oh,
roll
okay.
out.
You're feeling good about it.
Well, I mean, you're doing a great job, baby girl. You behind the glass. We can't touch you, so you pretty much can turn us off.
Can't slap the shit out of me.
She's doing everything. She's like Vishnu. She got like six arms, eight arms.
She's like who?
Vishnu.
What is that?
It's a Hindu god.
It's a Hindu god with like six arms.
I knew that. That's the one that turned you into stone.
Hysterical.
No, that's Medusa.
Right. Okay, cool. Same people. Same aura.
That's Greek. Actually, no.
No.
Completely different.
She has snakes. Snakes. Okay. Anyway, and what is it called again? It's called a what?
Vishnu. It's a Hindu god.
Vishnu.
Yeah, Vishnu.
Yeah, I just thought it was the devil.
Oh, gosh. No. Anyway.
Some satanic stuff.
Yeah, my mother told me, turn that shit off. I said, it's a book, man. Can't turn it off. It's a book. You want me to turn the page? That's can't turn it off.
Turn your pop-up book off.
I never forget somebody for Christmas gave us a Ouija board. My mother was.
No.
Oh,
we
no,
was,
that was
we was in prayer for like 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Jeez.
My mother
was like, what the hell is that? We was like, well, you put your hand on it and you close your eyes.
Devil. From Hasbro. It's a new game show where you conjure devils.
My mother said, if you don't get that shit out, go get the Bible. I said, how you say shit in Bible in the same?
Do you like boring board games? Well, this is not it. Do you like contacting spirits?
And this was in the 70s.
Yeah, that's fucked up. You can't do that.
And so you're supposed to put your, it was shaped like a diamond. You put your hands on it, all the kids, and you close your eyes, and it supposedly it tell, and you look.
Get out.
And it's an A, then you start spelling shit. Next thing you know, who is Charles? And then somebody goes, Charles died. Is he talking?
Oh, like
but you're seven.
Like that.
With a Ouija board.
Raise my allowance. Mom, it's speaking to me.
My mother went 51-50.
Yeah, you can't have a Ouija board.
Yeah,
no, not didn't have one.
Not no Baptist house.
No.
I don't even know how we got it. Somebody sent it. This lady that used to give, that my mom met in the store, she saw all of us with my mom. She felt bad for us, white lady. So she used to send us stuff every Christmas. In the mail, big
so
box.
She just
and the Ouija board was in there. She said, you keep all the other shit. Get that other shit out of my house. So me and my brother in the trash can playing with it. All right, let's go. We're going to see if this shit.
Heathens.
See if this devil will come on out of here. See if he work in a trash can.
That's a terrible gift.
Yeah. So but she used to send us all the stuff. And I assume she passed away because the gift stopped one year.
They just stopped coming.
No more boxes.
No more gifts.
Threw away my other one.
Yeah.
It is the all new rollout show. In the building, your boy Speedy.
I'm the poetess.
Nikki Pam.
RT the white boy.
And we got a special guest.
And we have a special guest. He is the author of Tupac 187, The Red Knight. He is also the producer of the documentary Tupac Assassination. Please welcome R.J. Bond to the show.
R.J. Hello.
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 Hey. Who's R.J. stand for?
Richard James, actually.
Rick James?
Well, Richard James, yeah.
Yeah, Rick James. This stands for Rick James. That's cool as fuck. Rick James.
You get a Rick James Bond.
That would have been.
That'd be a super spy brother.
Well, Bond. Rick James Bond.
RT, well, you're Richard, right?
Yeah, I'm a Richard, yeah.
Oh, wow, okay. Yeah.
Maybe so you guys know each other?
RJ and RT, that's good. Yeah. Okay. Well, we're white. We all know each other. Yeah, okay. We go back.
Yeah,
we go back.
Yeah, sorry. We all know each other. Hang out in the same hood.
Yeah. We go. Not a hood, Hope. Anyway, let's go.
So, RJ.
Neighborhood.
So RJ, you've been on this whole Tupac assassination, this whole Biggie thing for a number of years now, right?
You know what? It's been 10. Mm-hmm. 10 years. I looked back the other day. It's been 10 years I've been in this. Yeah.
And what inspired you to get involved with this whole conspiracy?
Well, originally, I didn't know much about it. The only thing I knew was I was best friends with Frank Alexander. Everybody knows Big Frank.
He used to be Tupac's
Tupac's bodyguard.
Bodyguard, right?
Yeah, yes. Tupac's bodyguard, yes. Up until the day he died.
Wow.
And he was always kind of obsessed with what happened and why.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, of course, it was his responsibility at that time. Mm-hmm. And he's gotten a lot of flack for it over the years. And he and I got together, and we were just talking about it one day. And he had done a movie called Before I Wake, Tupac Shakur Before I Wake. And a lot of people have seen that. It come out in 2002 or so. And we talked about it. We said, you know, why don't we do a follow-up to that? Why don't we see where everything's at, kind of take the pulse of the investigation? And that's kind of how the It's kind of how the dance started.
Wow. And from that, you were able to write the book. Would you say it's accurate? Would you say it's right on point? Or
I believe it to be. Yeah, I do. I do. You know, we've gotten kicked a couple of times. You know, there's a lot of disinformation out there. A lot of people, you know.
Just wanting to be a part of it.
You know, mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, the hard part today, the hard part today is that Tupac and Biggie both, you got to go back 30 years before somebody has a real personal firsthand knowledge of mm-hmm. when they were around.
Mm-hmm.
Because anybody that was mm-hmm. younger than 10,
yeah, they don't
know. They right. know, yeah. right? They play with their Ouija board.
Right.
Pretty much, yeah.
Right?
So Frank Alexander, rest in peace, because he died a few years ago. Do you think because the night that Tupac was shot, his security was told to leave their guns behind and to not carry any weapons. Do you think that Frank probably had a certain amount of guilt as a result of not carrying his weapon that night?
I think there was a couple of things. Yeah, no, I do. I do. And he talked about it, and he did. Mm-hmm. You know, he did.
Who told him to leave him behind?
Yeah.
Well, there was a cat by the name of Reggie Wright. And Reggie ran Death Row Security. He was an ex-Compton cop, and he was in charge of Death Row Security. And according to all the bodyguards and even some Death Row, you know, insiders, people, the driver, Suge's driver, they had this big meeting, and they got told, you know, for whatever reason they did it, don't take your weapons with you.
Because they don't always carry. Took them with you.
They did.
24/7.
24/7. And in fact, Frank went as far as to, I mean, of course, here you are. They don't tell you that before you leave to go to Vegas. Now, you're going to go to Vegas, you're going to carry your gun with you. Mm-hmm. Where are you going to put
right.
it? They tell you don't carry your gun. Where are you going to put it? You can leave it at the hotel? I don't know. I wouldn't.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know, mm-hmm. so Frank stuck his down in the car. And then after a certain point in time, with the fight ending early and everything that kind of happened, it became kind of a comedy of errors of things that, you know, Frank put his gun in his car, but his car was on the other side of the hotel, so he couldn't go back and get it. The fight ended early. It just brought out kind of the worst of the situation.
It was a Tyson-Bruce-Seldon fight?
Tyson-Seldon fight. Yeah, that one that lasted 8 seconds, and it was mm-hmm. done. You know,
yeah.
Got your money's worth out of that one.
So, did you also, on this project, work with former officer Russell Poole, who himself actually had been on the case 20-something years?
He did, and that's another rest in peace. Russell dropped dead from a heart attack not even a month ago.
Yeah, and yeah. It's ironic that they say it happened at the police station the sheriff's office.
It did. Russ was a cool cat. Russ was convinced that there was a lot bigger, I won't say conspiracy, but that there were a lot more cops involved than what they mm-hmm. wanted to let out and what the LAPD was willing to admit to. Mm-hmm. And because of that, he just always stayed with it. He kind of kept his pulse, finger on the pulse of what was going on. In later years, he kind of dropped out of the scene and went on living his life and that. And right about the time that we were done with the second assassination movie, a lot of the work I had done had been based on what he'd done
mm-hmm.
Back then. And he never got a chance to finish it because he pissed off a couple people at the police department. Mm-hmm. And they didn't want him pursuing things any further, and he quit. So he never had a chance to kind of go back into it again and really follow it up. And doing the book was a way for us to kind of put our notes together, Clash of the Titans, if you will, put it together and see, you know, if there were holes.
Now, for those who's probably just tuning in, when we're talking about Tupac.
And Biggie.
And when you go that big, when you say police, let's start with, because Pac was killed first. Mm-hmm. What was the reason, or what do you think the reason why he was killed? Because some people say, and I've heard a man from Public Enemy, the leader, he said one
Chucky?
Of the, yeah, he said
he
Chuck.
He said the leader.
Yeah,
the leader.
Chuck,
the militant
Chuck,
one.
Yeah.
The leader.
Chuck said that, or one of his things that he mentioned was that Pac was supposed to go back to jail because he was only out on parole, for those who don't know. I mean, out on bail. He was out on bail for $1 million bail, and he was supposed to go back, and he was talking about leaving Death Row. And so Suge didn't want him to leave, and did you get that sense of, or what is the?
Yeah, what did you find out?
Well, you know what? There's two or three different popular theories, if you will. Okay. They all kind of end at the same place. Mm-hmm. First one says that Suge didn't want Pac to leave. Pac was going to leave Death Row. Suge didn't want to leave, so he set up the whole thing and off he went.
Got it.
The other one was that it was just a random situation. They beat up Orlando Anderson, who was that cat at the MGM standing around. They beat him up, and then he got mad and drove around looking for him and happened to find him and, you know, shot him. And then the third one is actually the theory that Suge was actually really the target. That all of the other was true. They beat up Orlando Anderson, and that they actually, you know, Tupac was leaving Death Row. He was. I mean, there's enough people that we know that that was true. And they were going to have some future relationship. It wasn't like he was going to cut all ties with Suge. He was mad one night, told him, you know, if you have whatever you want, you know, I'm leaving. Kind of like Dre. I'm done. But ultimately, they were going to continue in some fashion. Tupac was going to do his own thing. That was Pac. Pac was Pac. He just always wanted to do his own thing. And Suge was cool with that. But there was enough going on at the time involving Suge and some of the nonsense that Suge was involved with that we believe that Suge was actually the one that was really set up that night. There were some people that wanted to get Suge out of the way.
Is that what you believe?
I do. I actually do. Okay. And that's changed for me. Because we always, in the assassination movies, we always had kind of a dotted line that said that Suge was somehow involved or he had some knowledge. You know, maybe it was plausible deniability.
I don't know if I can get with that because, I mean, the way they shot up Pac and he and Suge only got a graze, why they didn't shoot from the driver's side?
Well, if in the book, we call it amateur hour. That was the whole thing. I mean, when they had an opportunity, they set it up. The people that were the hitters, so to speak, were I'm not going to say all gang guys are bad shooters. That's not at all. Because I walk outside of here and all five that are really good shooters, I'm sure.
Right in the head.
Right there. Boom. One shot. Done. Okay.
What
they're good
saying,
shooters.
You own
okay.
Crenshaw?
Yeah, right. Exactly. So I say that they, the people that they picked to do it the first time out, and what we surmise is that the same cast of characters did both Biggie and Pac.
But what's the whole thing about the police killing Biggie? And that's why...
That's what they fixed. That's in our book and what we believe, that's actually how they fixed it. The first time, Pac did not go well. There, like I said, there was a lot of things that they expected to have happen that night. The fight lasted a little bit longer. You know, when they're trying to set up something to make it happen, anything can go wrong, and you have to have contingency plans for it. But because the people that they had hired actually, or not hired, but they asked or recruited to do the hit and do the shooting themselves weren't experienced in all that. So it really did become kind of a spur of the moment, not a lot of planning. Let's just get it done. And it was kind of amateur hour at that point.
So when it comes to Tupac, and remember when he got shot in New York, does anything have one have to do with the other?
No.
So it's just... He just happened to get shot at twice?
Yeah, he did. Well, you know, some people would just target for good luck like that, you know. In New York, a lot of people think Biggie had something to do with what happened in New York. And, you know, the truth is I've got a movie I'm working on with Atron Gregory, and I think you know Atron.
Yeah, I know Atron.
We've been working on a movie called Tupac, The Early Years. And it's literally a documentary about his earlier years up to that point.
Yeah, Atron used to be Tupac's manager and Digital Underground and stuff like that. So when I was doing the research for this interview, I saw what I consider some nonsense about Lil Half Dead being the one who killed Tupac. That, to me, is crazy.
Okay.
Is this something you're claiming in your book?
Well, here's what we claim in the book. And, you know, there's a lot of good reasons to believe that
I don't think that Lil Half Dead would kill Pac over Brenda's Got a Baby. That's just... And I know Lil Half Dead. I just can't see that.
You just don't see it.
Right.
I don't.
And the book... And we did the book similar to the way we did the movies. We put it out there. This is what came to us via Chris Blatchford, who's a very respectable Fox News reporter.
And, really?
Okay.
That's like jumbo shrimp.
There you go. Right. Yeah, there you go.
Hilarious.
All right. Or an honest stockbroker. The way it came to us and some of the things that were mentioned in it, it wasn't so much the fact that the letter was right on a lot of different things, but it was enough. There was enough that was in it for somebody who had written a letter. We're talking about years before Reggie Wright or anybody that was really named as a key person in any of this was ever brought to the surface. Years before, this letter shows up and it has elements in it that tie into where we had been in the first place. So we put it out there. We did not have time because the cat who wrote it, and I've got dozens of letters from him, the cat that wrote it is in prison. He's been given kind of a bum rap, but he's not the one who wrote the letter. He's just the one who delivered the letter. The one who wrote the letter, he dictated it, was alleged to be a fellow by the name of Danny Patton. And Danny Patton did it, and he gives the reasons why that happened. But at the end of the day, the reason that the letter mentions Little Half Dead, whether it's true or not, we don't really go into it. If you want to believe it's true, we give you a lot of good reasons to think about it being true. But we don't draw a conclusion, and that's something I started with the assassination movies, was just like, look, until the police investigate it, until it's really all done and over with, we don't know.
But here's my question. How can we ever get to the truth if the police are involved? There's no way to get to the truth.
Well, and that's Russ and I found that out the hard way. About a year ago, we went to the Los Angeles Police Department with this letter, that one that mentioned Little Half Dead and all that. Nobody knew that this letter existed but Blatchford, the people that wrote it, and us. It sat literally in a folder for 15 years. And we took the notes that we had, the letter, the things that we were able to follow up on, some bits and pieces we were able to follow up from the letter. And we took that letter to the Los Angeles Police Department because Russ still had some people that, that they knew. At the time, we met with three of the top brass chiefs of police of the Los Angeles Police Department. It was a room that had six people in it. Four LAPD, Russ Poole, and myself. That's it. We gave them a copy of the letter. I wouldn't even say 3 weeks later, that letter leaked out on the internet. Okay?
Okay, so let me ask you this.
Yeah.
What were you doing prior to just being Frank's friend, and what was your background prior to getting involved with this?
I had done movies. I've been involved with movies for years. I had my regular job, and then I had my side job, which was doing movies. I had done some low-budget feature films, and I had been involved with big movies like Titanic and movies like that down in Mexico. We shot it down there in the late 90s. But that's what I had
done. Wait, DiCaprio shot Tupac?
He was downstairs.
He was in Vegas.
Let me ask you this: do you think that there was conspiracy behind Frank Alexander's death and Russell Poole?
It's a good question. My personal opinion: I don't believe that Russ's death was a conspiracy. Frank's a different story altogether. Maybe because I'm a little more personally tied to Frank, he was godfather to my kids. You know, that's the kind of relationship Frank and I had. This wasn't a casual one. We were in each other's pockets all day. Russ had a history of heart problems and high blood pressure. I won't say heart problems. Let me step back. High blood pressure. And he wasn't happy with his medication. When I was talking with his family, he was exercising, doing the things that he needed to do. But even I'm willing to draw a point in the line and say, okay, wait a minute, you know, not everything is a conspiracy. Right. Some things just are what they are.
Right.
Russ was so desperate to want to have somebody follow up with, like, to answer your question about this, will this ever get solved? He wanted somebody, maybe somebody that wasn't part of LAPD, somebody outside of the loop on what was going on, to believe him enough that maybe they could start some sort of side investigation. It would be like in the olden days when you used to go to the newspaper. And you find a reporter that would dig in, and he wouldn't care about the cops.
He'd
go, go find the truth.
You know? I'll do it.
But that was the San Jose Mercury reporter that did that, right? He went and did a full investigation on the whole Tupac death row thing. I think he passed away too.
The same one that did the cocaine one, that did the CIA connection.
I can't think of his name right now, but he passed away as well. But
yeah, I think the same guy. Yeah.
And the fellas that want to look at Frank's death was a very strange circumstance. There was nothing that led up to it in terms of externally. He had some internal fighting going on with the wife and all that, but other than that, there just wasn't anything that would have led to that. And Frank was nobody to ever want to kill himself, you know. But you know, Frank died, and then I wouldn't even say 3 months later, Michael Moore, who was another one of security people for death row, he died. Russ Poole died.
Well, how did Frank pass? How did he die?
Well, they say he shot himself in the head.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
Okay. Now, that anybody that knew Frank and knows everybody that knew Frank, knows that Frank was an ex-Marine. You know, he just, there was just no way he wouldn't go out
mistake.
Like that. No.
Yeah, he's not gonna make
they,
a
you know,
mistake.
Cleaning his gun or whatever right. and go yeah, off. Right. No. But that was the official rule. I've gone to Murrieta, the city that he lived in. I've been to their police department 3 times with subpoenas to get a copy of that death report, find out the truth, and they have fought me on it every step of the way.
I know just being, I don't say on the streets, but just being not in that particular loop, we always thought that when Pac died, that it was just a matter of time to when someone was going to go Biggie. Get Biggie, because it was like these two guys had a beef. There's no way you're going to let one of ours die. That's how we felt. And then Biggie not be next. So it was really weird when he came here, when he even like, yo, mm-hmm. Biggie in town. For what? Why would he do that?
Yeah,
he got to know is, you know, even if what you're saying is true, we didn't know about the police. We never thought that high. We just figured, well, somebody's going to want to take revenge mm-hmm. for Pac not being here anymore. There's no way Biggie going to just, you know, live his life. So when he came here, we couldn't believe, and then when it happened, we was like, well.
But let alone in their songs, they both predicted it too.
Yeah.
That's the spooky part about the whole thing.
And you know, it's funny because, like I said, we're doing this movie in the early years, and the truth is that, you know, Biggie and Pac were much closer friends than anybody would know. When Pac got busted for the rape case, when mm-hmm. they actually came up and got him out, Charles Fuller, Man-Man, who mm-hmm. was his best friend at that time, Man-Man said that, you know, one of the mistakes they made, Pac used to carry 2 9s. Mm-hmm. Carry them in the front. They call them the twins. Mm-hmm. And he had taken them and put them inside the piano mm-hmm. at that time when he was going to lay down when the girl was up in the room. Mm-hmm. He put them down in the piano. When the cops came up to the room in New York to get them all out of there and they're going to arrest them, it dawned on them as they were being taken to the police station that if the cops ever went back to the room, they were going to find the guns. And now you got a whole different kind of problem.
Yeah, especially in New York.
You got a whole new problem.
Right.
Yeah. So they, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? You know who went back and got the guns with Man-Man? Was Biggie.
Mm.
Biggie went back and got those guns. Biggie was at the hospital after Pac got shot.
The first time.
Yeah. Gloria Cox, who's his aunt, said, you know, Biggie was there. He was crying. He was as upset as anybody about it.
Yeah, I don't really think that Biggie had anything to do with that. So,
I don't either. Mm-mm.
So you're reissuing the Tupac 187 book on the, I think this year was the 19th anniversary of Tupac's passing.
It's been that long, can you believe it?
Yeah, it's been a while. So mm-hmm. And I think I read somewhere you're also working on another documentary, part 2 to the assassination.
Well, no, actually we're working on the early years, the Tupac the early years.
Yeah,
I needed to take a break from the death.
Right. Enjoy the life. Right. Yeah.
You spend 10 years talking about death and surrounding yourself with death. It takes you some very
weird
places.
It's just really scary because when I did the research last night, just all the people involved with this case, so many people died. It was just, it's just like some people are almost afraid to really speak on it because you feel like you might become a target.
Right.
Did you ever feel like your life was in danger being involved with this project?
Well, there's an interview done with Reggie Wright no more mm-hmm. than about 3 or 4 weeks ago where he was quoted as saying R.J. Bonds will be next.
Mm. Okay. Oh.
Yeah, so, you know.
Put a hex on you.
Yeah, exactly. Well, get that Ouija board.
Yeah, get the Ouija board. I'll see what it says.
Back out.
Wow. That's terrible.
You hear about this and you do, and so many people have, in fact, died. People call me all the time, be careful, man. You be careful out there, man.
Right.
I generally don't go down to areas where somebody might be looking for me to be. So.
Now, has any of the, because you know they want to do a movie about Pac, has anybody reached out to you to come consult on any of these movies?
You know, after the Straight Outta Compton.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, you know, I run in a lot of the same circles with a lot of the people that are actually involved with that. Mm-hmm. Lee Savage is one of the writers of Straight Outta Compton. You mm-hmm. know,
he's going to be on the show actually next week.
Oh, that'd be great. Nice. Yeah, Lee's a great guy. You know, a lot of the same people that were involved with the Straight Outta Compton project, Adrian Gregory and these people, you know, you're one step away from all these. You know, they call mm-hmm. it whatever that 5 degrees of separation or whatever it is, 6 degrees. You always have that closeness with these people. So to answer your question directly, no, not really, because I've been involved with the kind of the other side of the coin. It's the unpleasant side that people don't like to think about a lot. You know, it's the death. And that's part of the reason why I got into the life side of it because, you know.
Yeah, get out of here.
Okay. What do you have to say to people who say that you're profiting off of this? Are you because I read about that as doing the research, mm-hmm. so I have to ask.
Well, I get hit about that a lot. As far as profiting goes, well, I mean, there's a lot of people that profit off of Tupac, music companies, everybody else, you know, profits off of him. You know,
I mean, is this more to you than making a profit?
It's much more to me making a profit, especially after Frank died. It became much more personal.
Absolutely.
I had a heart attack in 2013, October, and it had a lot to do with the stress of Frank passing away, losing my best friend, and the burden of that. But because Frank made it his mission in life to try to find out the truth of what was going on, no matter what, and he wasn't afraid to confront anybody about it. Mm-hmm. I watched him ready to shoot Suge Knight straight cold at the Magic Show in Las Vegas.
Wow.
You know, he said,
I could tell that Russell Pohl was very passionate about the cause, because he said he was at the point of suicide at one point.
He was. So. It really bothered Russ. It bothered Russ a lot, which is why he was so glad. And it's funny because we had done the assassination movies without him. We did two of them without Russ. And so I sent him copies of the movies. He hadn't seen them and was so happy. You know, he brought boxes, mm-hmm. half the stuff I got here, big boxes of stuff over to share and say, where can we go?
Well, we have a call. Let's take this call. Caller, what's your name and where are you calling from?
Chicago.
Hey, and what's your name?
What's your name?
Terrell.
Okay, Terrell. Do you have a question, Terrell?
Hey, Terrell.
Yeah, I just wanted to ask a question real quick about Suge, because he said that they was, gunning for Suge, because I've been, ever since the NWA movie, I've been seeing a lot of things on YouTube and these blogs, and they've been saying that, Suge was raping grown men and sodomizing them, and I just wanted to know, did that didn't have anything to do with it, and was is that true?
As a form of intimidation, I think.
Boy, so many places we go with this shit.
What's the address that happened at? And what time do I need to be there?
He sounded like he was in jail with him. I'm in the cell. Is it true?
Chicago.
Tell me it's not true.
I don't know. I mean, we've all heard the rumors.
Yeah, I mean, what do we know? Yeah.
I'll say this much. When you're in power, all kind of shit happens.
Mm-hmm. All kind of rumors are made.
You saw
in the
UA, you know what they say. Hey. You know, if it's on a movie, it must
they
be true, right?
Let me ask one more question. Russell Pohl, when he had the heart attack, or when he died at the police, the sheriff's office, was he actually there interviewing him still on the Biggie Tupac case? Because that's what I read, that he was there actually to interview them about it, but I also heard that he got threats from the police during his time in this investigation.
There's two trains of thought. The first off, Michael Carlin, who was our ghostwriter, who ghost wrote the book with Russ and I.
I guess he ain't a ghostwriter now.
Well, he's a ghost. He's somewhere.
Damn.
I don't know where he is.
Oh, everybody.
Changed his phone number five times.
Yeah, we're going to have to hurry up and get you out of here. I don't want to curse your studio.
Someone might die.
Black cloud. No, Michael says Russ was at the police station talking about the Tupac case, talking about the Biggie case. Mm-hmm. What a lot of people don't know about Russ is that Russ had a brother who very early in his investigation of the Rampart Division, his brother, who was a year or two younger than Russ, disappeared off the face of the earth. Literally, truck was still there, ID was still in the house. He has disappeared, and it's still an unsolved case. They have no idea whatever happened.
Russell Pohl's brother?
Russell Pohl's
Damn.
Brother,
wow.
Yeah.
Jimmy Hoffa style.
Yeah.
The guy I was thinking about, the reporter, is Gary Webb. He
Gary
actually
Webb, yeah. yep.
was reporting on the Rampart and the mm-hmm. drugs and the... I mean, it was...
It's got to be the most corrupt police station I've ever seen.
It's a mess.
I went to the
goodness.
Little holding cell in
yeah,
Rampart.
It's a,
did?
It's a mess.
Yeah. Is that where you... Hilarious.
There was only one in...
We always
didn't see Terrell
time.
There, did you, by any chance?
Huh?
You didn't see Terrell there.
No. We always knew growing up that Rampart, if they chased you, you better get away. Because if they catch you,
really?
That's
well,
your
they
ass.
Did that whole show, The Shield, they did that whole show off of Rampart.
Off of Rampart.
Oh, really?
Yeah, that's what it was based
that.
On.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
It was
didn't
based on Rampart. Yeah, all those shenanigans. Yeah.
Okay, so where could people find information about, you know, your projects and your investigation and follow the new project you're working on with Early Years?
Sure. We have a blog. It's called Tupac187.blogspot.com. And you can go there, and what we've kind of done is set that up as an extension of the book. We just like the investigation, just because I wrote a book doesn't mean we're not still looking. Mm-hmm. And if that letter doesn't pan out, it doesn't pan out. We're going to look someplace else.
Do you think this will ever be solved, or it will ever come to light of the true story of how both these artists?
Let me get this out there. There's a story that just popped up a few days ago that some Las Vegas cop on his deathbed, this is kind of a hoax story, said that they paid $1.5 million to sneak Tupac out of Vegas, and he's still alive, living somewhere. Mm-hmm. You know, you hear this from time to time.
With Elvis, he's living with Elvis. There.
Well, that brought up it did bring up an interesting point that Russ said. Russ said that this case will never get solved unless somebody has a deathbed confession of some sort. Mm-hmm. That it will take something of that magnitude to bring it to light. And until then, it's going to be solved by the media and by the public before it'll be solved by law enforcement.
That makes sense.
All right. Well, thank you, RJ, for the interview. We appreciate it.
Deep. We don't know where to go with this shit.
We know somebody's going to die.
What you got for us, Pete?
We're already playing. What the fuck you talking about?
We're going to take a quick break.
Into this shit.
And we'll be right back.
And the dude getting raped, don't get raped no more.
It's the all new rollout show. We'll be right back.
Wow. Hey, y'all. This is what white folks play at all karaoke.
Everybody, yeah. But you cannot sing it.
Black folks know the song.
What's his name, the lead singer again?
Him.
What's his name?
Steve Perry?
Yeah, Steve Perry. Nobody can
come on,
him.
Steve Perry.
How does a white guy know it?
Don't even try it.
Yeah, the white guy knows it.
Was that your phone going off?
Yeah,
that's annoying.
Mm. Yeah, kids is lost. Anyway, it's the all new rollout show, and I am Speedy. And
I'm the poetess.
Turn your shit up.
Nikki, Pam, yeah, we can't hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Call me now.
Call me now.
Call in, you guys. RJ is going to give away three books.
Three books.
Wow.
Oh, shit. So we'll just make it simple.
Yeah, just call.
The first three callers.
Yeah.
How about this? Let's just do the first two motherfuckers they call. First three?
We'll do the first two callers because we want a book.
Yeah, we're going to keep it.
We only have two books. Only two books. We ain't got no motherfucking three books. So, anyway.
The number's on the screen. 323. Somebody wants a book.
Probably two books. Send me my book.
We got people that can read out there. This is awesome.
I know. Who knew?
We got such intelligent viewership.
Yes, we do.
Do we have a call?
Same.
We have a call. Caller, what's your name and where you calling from?
Calling from the D.C. area.
What's your name?
My name is to be left not saying it.
Oh. Okay, cool. How you going to get the book?
Okay.
We're going to mail it to Incognito.
Right, in D.C.
In D.C.
What's up, dog? What can we do for you?
No, I was just calling to win the damn book.
Well, how are we supposed to know who
you
winning?
Are? Fuck you are. We can't right? send you the book.
You don't want to give it out over the airwaves?
Did you go see the Pope today?
No, I ain't see him, but there was a gang of people standing out in the streets.
Yeah, they fucked your city up.
Yeah, blocking me from getting lunch.
Is this Chuck Farmer?
He said not to know his name, Chuck. Oh, I'm sorry, Chuck.
Chuck ain't even his real name.
Oh, okay, my bad. Dude to make the memes.
Jimmy Farmer.
All right, we get you the book. You just got to stay on the line.
Hang on the line and let our beautiful intern get your
info.
Yeah, she's 12. Don't try to get to know her. She's 12.
You at least got to give us a fake name. Come on.
I know. Make you up something next time. Don't just.
Oh, I could give you a fake name now.
All right, go. Who's on the phone?
Y'all ready?
Yeah.
I don't have a name.
This is the worst.
Hold on. I'm almost.
You don't even get the book now.
No book.
We'll give you the cover.
Yeah. You get the sleeve. Read that.
Yeah.
Punk.
Yeah.
Y'all got my news theme music ready?
Yes, I'm
ba,
ready.
Ba, ba, ba,
hold on.
Oh. Y'all are so. Ba, ba,
like, hold on,
where's
Sugarfoot.
Where's DJ always when
this you just in your blood. It's the wide world of news. And Speedy's agony of his feet.
As soon as you hear this, you want to go, and it's now time for the poetess.
I think of like Ted, not Ted Koppel.
Ted Koppel Nightline. This
Brian
is Nightline.
Brian Williams, he's back
died.
Now.
One of them died, didn't they?
Oh, damn.
What about Tom Brokaw?
Yeah, Tom.
What kind of reporting are you? Somebody died?
Let me say it, ladies. Tom Brokaw.
Why you drink my water? Gosh.
I'm sorry.
He put his mouth all on it.
Okay. Well, here's a pill story.
Pam's ears perked up.
Right. I did. I got.
And her bladder.
A man. His name is, what's this? through. It's your story. Anyway, I don't even know how to pronounce his name, but because it starts with a S-H-K.
Uh-oh.
Shkreli.
Shkreel.
Well, this guy from Turing Pharmaceuticals bought the patent to the...
Oh, I heard about this. Bought
Detriment.
The...
What's it called? Daripin.
Detriment?
The AIDS pill.
There it is.
Yeah, and he raised the
Daripin,
price.
Daripin, I think he raised that's what the it's price. Called. Yeah. And it went from $13.50 to $750.
Wow.
He just came back last night.
Huh?
He just... Because at first he said he wasn't going to bring the price down. Fuck you.
Right.
And then last night.
That's right. So wrong on every level.
You're right, Speedy.
Yeah. What?
So many people were like outraged.
Appalled.
At this guy to take something. Like, it's not only for AIDS. It's for stuff people who have a lower immune system.
But I truly believe that he did it because it was AIDS patients. And that you have to have the pill,
or you're gonna die.
So,
wow,
fuck your $13. I need $750.
Wow.
Yeah, you want to live $750.
Wow, that's cold blooded.
That that's cold blooded. That's
when they interviewed him yesterday during the morning because I watch CNBC every morning. He was like, the lady said, "Are you gonna bring the price down?" He said, "Hell no, I ain't bringing nothing down." Stood there, perked
he
up.
Said, he said, "I didn't charge enough."
Yeah,
really?
That's not even the going market. So. 12 o'clock last night, he had his head all low reading from the paper. I will bring the price down.
But he didn't say he didn't say how much.
He didn't say he was going to bring it down. And it ain't $13.50.
And he used to do like a...
We got a phone call.
We got a call. Caller, what's your name and where you calling from?
This is Tom Foolery calling from the big city.
What's
hey,
up?
Tom.
What you want, Tom?
What's going on? My bad, Paul, is I ain't mean to call and interrupt your segment or nothing.
Yes,
you did. Yeah, he
wants the book.
You want the book?
No. Monday I was at work, so I ain't get a chance to wish my nigga Speedy happy belated birthday.
There you go.
Thank you, Tom.
And RT, I ain't never really get a chance to talk to RT. RT, you a funny motherfucker, man.
Thanks, man. Appreciate that.
On YouTube and all that. You a funny dude.
Oh, thanks, man. Appreciate that.
But that's why I call Speedy happy birthday. I'll not be giving you shit all the time on the net. And
yeah, you be talking most shit. But,
thank you, Tom Fuller.
It's all love. But that's all I
call. Wow. He didn't seem mad at me.
Bye, Tom.
Tom Foolery. He can be mad at me. It's
the
a problem.
Shit talker.
Yeah.
Okay, so next story. A woman sues...
Thank you, Tom.
...the police department in Detroit because she was pulled over. And so they're looking through her car and they find this medication. And they ask her what the medication is for, and she says, "I'm HIV positive."
Okay.
So basically, the cop gave her a ticket and harassed her for being HIV positive.
Gave her the ticket with gloves
on.
And there's your ticket.
Well, that's what the stuff I read. This cop said he was an asshole.
Get your TC.
Why you didn't tell me prior? Why didn't you tell me in the first place? I could have had my gloves on and all this stuff.
Oh, wow.
I want to come back to...
Dick.
He was...
What is wrong with these motherfuckers,
these
man?
These cops is out of control.
What? Yeah. No, seriously.
Out of control.
What the fuck is wrong with these niggas? I mean, it's like you hear... It's like story of story. Even if you're a fucked up cop to begin with, you have to go, oh, shit.
All right, like, you know how it is. This is what I'm convinced it is. It's like, you know how it is when you work a job and it's so fucking boring that you're just like, I'll actually work. I'll actually do something now. And I think that's what cops do. Cops are so fucking bored that they have to find something to get into.
To pick on people about.
Yeah, and they're gonna fuck with you or pull a gun out or do something. And that's how shit goes
bad. And you
bad.
Mad at the motherfucker for having AIDS.
Right, what's wrong with you? What the fuck is wrong with you?
And you're really not entitled to tell the police that you're HIV positive.
Yeah, why did she even do that?
Well, she told him because he found the pills.
Oh, there you go. Yeah, you got to find out what that is.
Pam, what do you say when a cop pulls you over?
I got it all.
This one's for my glaucoma. This is for my...
I got shingles.
So all this was caught on tape, and the stuff this guy was saying was just...
And this pill is to remind me to take the other pill.
Oh, these M&Ms, them ain't M&Ms.
Right.
But really, the cops, they just looking for stuff to get into, and they want to just... And they cause mischief.
They assholes.
Because a lot of the... Look, like, why pull someone over for a light out over the license plate?
Right.
I told you why.
Why?
That's how they caught Ted Bundy.
Oh, that's true.
That's how they caught Ted Bundy. He had a busted taillight.
Well, it worked that time, but that's it. We got to stop this nonsense.
So I think ever since then, that's been like pretty much on their protocol that you don't know what's going to lead to something else. And he got pulled over having a busted taillight. And from that busted taillight, He didn't know. He forgot about it. He thought he was getting pulled over for.
So it's like the shoe bomber. Everybody got to pay for fucking shoe.
Right,
one dude gets pulled over.
Except for an Oakland.
One dude.
Shout out to Oakland Airport.
I don't think that's why, Speedy.
No,
come
really.
On.
That's, no.
Shut well, up. Ted Bundy, that might have happened. I agree with
no,
you.
No, that did happen. Mm-hmm. But shout out to Oakland. They don't make you take your shoes off no more.
They
oh,
don't?
Really? No, Oakland Airport, you keep your shoes on at the airport. Yeah. So shout out to them for being smart enough to know.
Because real men keep their guns in the waistband.
I ain't putting a fucking bomb in my new
right,
Jordan,
right.
motherfucker.
We know you
And the dude that did it, it wasn't really even a bomb. It was just some shit he had rigged up, and they said it was never going to work.
Well, it was a Wile E. Coyote bomb. It had a goddamn fuse coming out of his fucking shoe.
I know,
shoe.
Right?
Stupid motherfucker.
We have another call. Caller, what's your name and where you calling from? Hey, caller, what's your name?
What's your name?
Rich Martin from North Philly.
Hey, what's
hey,
up,
Rex?
Guys?
Hey, Rich.
What you want,
oh, Rich. Yeah.
You got a phone call, Rich.
That's
no,
Martin.
I'm actually on the phone.
Oh, okay.
So, Rich.
What you want, Rich? You want some shit?
Calling for the
one,
book?
Is the book still available?
Yes. Yes. Yeah, one more.
You
left.
Are the second.
I happen to know that Rich doesn't drive, so he'll have some reading material while he's on public transportation.
Hysterical.
Oh, you threw him under the bus.
Right. He's the homie.
I'm sorry, you threw him under the vehicle he riding in?
Threw him under the Uber.
They had to go, this your last stop, dog? Oh, my bad.
Hang right. on the line.
There you
Ryan
go. You
trying
get
to take your info. Really.
Thank you for calling, man. Appreciate that. And you better go on the cruise.
He anyway. Actually also I mean, won the meme contest 2 weeks ago.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, personal.
Which meme did you
He's
do?
A fan.
I'm in touch with the fans. I appreciate them.
Boy,
we're
if they
like
could
family.
Touch you. Business. Y'all don't know how big they are. Anyway, going back to your story. I'm sorry. I always get because they're
distracted.
They're very big. And they're very real.
Why do you always state the obvious? Like, you know.
I am Captain Obvious on that. Sorry, yes. I apologize.
Captain Obvious.
I love that commercial.
Yeah, it's hilarious.
Anyway, next story.
She's like, enough about my tits.
Right.
they're actually
my big tits.
Ditties.
A man punches an elder man at a supermarket because he ate the last piece of waffle with Nutella on it.
With what?
Ever taste the Nutella?
Yes,
is it Nutella?
It's really good. I love it.
What is it again?
Nutella.
Nutella.
The like peanut butter kind
no,
of
No, it's
stuff.
Like a chocolate spread. It's a chocolate spread.
Okay, so you know how they have the samples at the supermarket.
Mm-hmm.
Oh,
hilarious.
You come there, you act like you don't want to. I guess I'll try three of them.
No, I couldn't. I'll take six.
Yeah, yeah. And you come around with a different basket every time. Hey.
Come back with a disguise. Oh, it's a mustache. Not me.
Hey, little kid, get in this basket and ask for one of the things.
So they have the
can
little.
Can I borrow your kid, ma'am?
They have the little tray, you know, the table with the samples on it. Yeah. And the little samples with the Nutella. And so this kid was up there eating up all the Nutella. So the older dude came up and said, hey, slow
little
down. I want one.
I want a Nutella.
Nutella.
I came here for the Nutella.
Yeah. You just go sit here and eat the last one. And the dude turned around and punched the old guy in his face.
Damn. Oh,
wow.
Yes.
Somebody
and so
was
the
having
guy
a bad day.
Ended up having to go to the hospital. And the younger dude was arrested for elderly abuse.
So, Nutella, good enough to make you smack an old man. So, Nutella.
What did they put on it? Nutella? You know Tella? I know
you know Tella.
Tella.
I know Tella.
I get it. I was like, first I had to get
don't worry
the
about
old
it.
Man
like,
is ooh. Pissed.
Wow. Yeah, he probably did.
He was upset because he's like, this kid's disrespecting him. He can only eat a few items, and waffles with Nutella is one of them.
But you... And you know the shit didn't start on the one. He probably like, so you don't eat the third one?
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. And then some more, and he waited,
yeah,
and my man was
fault.
Like, so you're supposed to move. Don't tell me to do, you old motherfucker. I'll knock you the fuck out. So you don't eat another one?
Back
yes,
up off me.
I'm going to eat another one. That back up off me, and you're going to get the shit knocked out of you. You ain't going to hit me, motherfucker. You're going to move so I can get one of these Nutellas.
Oh, he hit me. Oh,
right.
Yeah.
Motherfucker socked me.
Can you find my teeth?
But can you still give me a Nutella?
Is it just me? But when I go to Costco, I was just at Costco picking up your damn cake, and they look at you like only one. Now, how somebody sat there and ate five?
He probably socked them too.
I'm like,
he probably had the munchies.
Sometimes I want two.
Well, I did that for
two.
A prank one time in Atlanta, and we filmed. I don't know what happened to it, but Chick-fil-A was down there, and they came out there with the nuggets.
Okay,
but you know they Christian, so they got to be like really nice.
Yeah.
So they came out there with the nuggets, and my dumb ass just sat there for like 20 minutes eating nuggets. He's like, sir, you can't eat any more nuggets. I was like, okay, what you gonna do though? He's like, sir, please stop eating the nuggets. I'll have to tell the manager. I was like, well, get him. And then she got the manager.
nuggets.
Old nice Christian manager came out. Sir, you can't eat any more nuggets. And I was like, okay, well, what you gonna do that? We're gonna take the nuggets away is what we're gonna do. No more nuggets for anyone. I was like, okay, well, I eat like 30
RT,
nuggets.
You ate all the fucking nuggets for a prank.
For a prank. It was funny as shit. Because they're so Christian, they have to be really nice to you. So they were just like, sir, please, please stop. I'm like, what are you going
to
do? Start
eating the nuggets.
Had you been gay, they'd have snatched the motherfuckers off you real fast.
He's a flamer. Take the nuggets away.
He likes dicks. Anyway.
He doesn't eat sweet and sour.
Not one more, so I got two more. But
whatever.
This is a terrible story.
You always seem to bring us there. You always take us up and go,
yeah,
okay, let's lift on us a different up, note.
And then we go back down.
Okay, come on.
It's terrible, but I know you heathens got jokes.
Rev your engines.
This man, where is he from?
Florida?
Florida. Everybody's
from
Florida.
It all starts in Florida. Oh, my God. He's from Florida.
Of course.
Who'd have thunk it?
Who'd have thunk it?
Right.
This guy.
Florida. America's dick.
Killed his girlfriend because she hollered out another man's name during sex.
Oh. Wait. He killed her because she called out someone else's
name. Her ex-husband's
name.
How did he kill her? Strangle her?
Do we have to have
that's
a way?
The That's the gross part.
Oh, okay.
That he what?
See him choking the bitch. But.
Okay, so she yelled it out not one time, twice. And so he went into.
Oh, Billy.
How disrespectful.
Billy.
You never seen he went into a fit of anger. And I think he was high on something because he pulled her guts out, literally.
Mm. Oh.
And I think he went up her vagina.
Oh, shut up.
Right, Portis.
oh, disemboweled her.
Yeah, that's exactly the word. That's exactly the word.
That's foul.
Okay, so wait. He pulled it through her vagina when he cut it?
That's the story.
He gave her a hysterectomy?
Like a magician's handkerchief?
Wait, how can you even do that? Well, I guess so.
Well, they say you got got like 100 miles of guts in you.
You are just so wrong.
When does it stop? Call the police.
So it took the whole night. Yeah. It took the whole night.
Sun comes up. It's like, I got tennis elbow.
Oh, my God. This is terrible.
Archie is such a heathen.
It's such a horrible story that you got to find something funny. I mean, that's fucking horrific.
Speedy, what are you?
You know that was funny.
That was funny.
That's fucked up. That is really fucked up. I probably shouldn't have did this.
I kept going. He's doing that and pulling the mic. Oh, a baby. Go back.
Cops are like, we're going to need two body bags.
Okay, okay.
Portis, from here on out. Portis, from here on out, when you have. Make those the last stories. Don't give that shit and go, okay, in another news. Like, we can regroup and go to some other shit.
In other news, a girl won a spelling bee.
Speaking of snakes, look at yeah, you can't do that. Oh, and then I hate when you go, you fuck up, and you go, I shouldn't do that.
but really,
why'd you do it?
That might be the worst story we've ever heard.
And she told us it, and then she went, yes, like we had to guess what the fuck happened.
That's what happened. He disemboweled her.
Like, how do you
that,
boy?
Even came
how do you
up
tell that story and go,
I know, I feel bad. I
don't know if
did
I should do this story.
That is funny.
So,
that's like that joke you know like you shouldn't
do. It's like eating a piece of cake when you're on a diet. Damn, and I shouldn't have did it.
And you ate all the cake and you went,
damn.
I shouldn't eat that cake.
Right.
I don't feel so
like
good.
Like when you masturbate, Speedy, and you go, damn, I'm better than this.
Yeah, I need to pull my pants up and get out of the food court. This is the bullshit.
I will disembowel you, bitch.
Disembowel? Wow, look at you using a big word.
Yeah. Yeah, baby.
That's our word of the day, disembowel.
Okay, Sean Penn is suing Lee Daniels.
I saw that.
Really,
for $10 million for accusing him of domestic violence. He, I guess Lee Daniels was doing an interview, and he claims that, you know, Terrence Howard has been in the news about domestic violence. And he claims it's like, it's nothing different than Humphrey Bogart and Sean Penn. He threw a man like they slapped on their women. Nobody said anything. So
wait, so why is he suing? I don't get
because
what the
he
fuck?
Felt because he said it's not
it's
true.
It's slander.
Yeah, slander. Yeah.
Wait, what he should have said? What's my?
He was using that as an example.
Right.
Humphrey Bogart slapped, and so did Sean Penn.
Right.
As if though it's okay to hit a woman again.
Right.
It's
like
not
no
okay
big
to
deal.
Hit a woman. These motherfuckers.
But he's always.
And I'll go back to Lee Daniels. I met Lee Daniels. Nice guy. But just you making it seem like it's okay to hit a woman. And that because these guys did it, it's okay for Terrence Howard to do it.
Right.
Which means Terrence he doesn't have any daughters.
He was saying those guys got away with it, but so you won't let Terrence get away with it.
Fuck that. Nobody should get
so
away.
He was standing up for him.
Right. He was standing up for him.
Fuck Lee Daniels. Fuck all the motherfuckers. I will not. Well, I'll watch tonight's show, but I'm not going
to
watch it.
You can hit a woman if she wants to be hit. If she's like, hit me. And you're like, okay, I'll hit you.
No.
Like,
but you know.
You never had that,
There were reports.
Girls like to get slapped.
In bed.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying.
You didn't say that, motherfucker. Oh. You waited for her to disembowel you and then say it. You two niggas.
It's like a fortune cookie. You got to add in bed to it.
Well, if you recall, Sean Penn used to date Madonna.
That's what, didn't he hit
and
hit her.
They say that he
now
used
be careful.
To,
we ain't got to mean.
Allegedly.
There you go.
Right.
Used to slap her around.
Well, I think that was bullshit because he was really just voguing. He was just like.
And got too
no,
close.
No, you didn't do the hands. Are you doing the hands? Remember, that's how you knew a dude was gay. And that motherfucker's in the club doing this shit. Motherfucker, you better not dance with him.
You better not pose in the. You better not pose in the window, bubba.
Yeah, this motherfucker is a genie. That's what everybody was King Tut. Remember that King?
That's about it. It's all you.
When you was
if
doing
you
when
can
you
cut
was
it out.
I'm gonna let you know if your man Vogue.
I agree. Or a kick.
Yeah, because King Tut
kick.
Hands
yeah,
out.
If you do a kick
he
in a club.
He said King Tut hands out.
Hands out. You can't hands up and in.
Hands
out.
You can
hands out.
You can do dynamite. It's cool.
Yeah.
End mic.
Yeah.
Go in
mic. Dynamite.
Yeah. Yeah. No, this can't dynamite.
A YMCA. He can't.
Here's
do
the
that.
Thing, though. For Sean Penn to even do that, he wants some recognition. Because you got to know, homie, there is records that you hit her. It ain't
no,
like that.
There's no record.
There was never a police report filed. There was
so
never,
how do you know he hit her?
It was in
allegedly.
The news.
Then, yeah, no, I mean,
and that
I
news report
that.
Is still out.
Huh?
What I'm saying is people act like you can't research. So you go, yo, you try, I'm going to sue
well,
you for
he
saying.
Well, he has a reputation of not being one of the
allegedly.
Yeah, very cray. Nice. I ain't got to allege. I'm saying what I heard.
Nigga, we on 43rd and Crenshaw. You better
let him come down here.
Oh, yeah, you ain't had no dick either? Yeah, you ain't.
Let Sean Penn come down here.
No, I mean, I heard he was not that nice of a
yeah,
guy.
He's cray-cray.
Yeah.
Borderline, allegedly. Yeah.
Well, $10 million ain't shit. So apparently this shit ain't true.
That is for
I just don't
I
like
think
the fact,
that's even something for Lee Daniels.
I just don't like the fact that Lee Daniels made it seem like it's okay to hit a woman.
Yeah.
That's
yeah,
the problem
that's
I have.
Thing, yeah. Well, he,
and I have daughters and sisters.
We know.
I have friends.
We know what
Pam.
His preference is.
I just feel like anytime a man doesn't stand up for that, oh boy, wrong. If he hit
and
his girl.
And why are you throwing race in it? That he tried to play the race card with this.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah. Two white folks. Yes, he did.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he did. He tried to play.
Well,
the
if you
want
to put
Lee people, Daniels did.
Yeah, and I met, like I said, I met Lee Daniels, and he seemed pretty cool on the red carpet. Hey, motherfucker!
Did he slap you? Oh, it's Lee Daniels. Oh shit!
Or Sean Penn.
Sean
either
Penn.
Way, go.
Sean Penn.
And speaking of Lee Daniels, the new season of Empire
tonight
starts tonight.
She just
yeah,
well, yeah. Well, that's the other thing I hate about you too. You
she
always
really
preempt our shit.
Just because I said the damn show premieres tonight, I didn't say nothing else.
And my buddy writes
you
on
you don't change
show.
Your tone.
No,
and
you
your
ain't
deliverance.
Gonna do shit.
Oh, and disembowel you. I know that goddamn.
Oh, there's gonna be a slap.
One more little entertainment tidbit.
Let me guess. One of my. Go ahead.
Yeah, go ahead.
Watch which one do I
would
go
you like
be.
To know what we gonna talk
no,
about?
No, go ahead. Go ahead. Go ahead.
Did he top the Forbes
wow,
list?
Really?
Oh, okay.
Bullshit, I had that written right here. It says Diddy.
Yeah, he do. Yeah, he do.
Oh, this motherfucker in the trash. Go ahead. Go
oh, then I'll stop right there.
Go with your
no,
story. No,
no,
go.
Diddy topped the Forbes list of
again?
The world's highest paid stars in hip-hop music.
Well,
is he
yeah,
still making money?
Of course.
Ciroc. Yeah, he has Ciroc, Revolt TV.
That's all he needs is Ciroc, really.
Yeah, Ciroc is on fire.
Woo, that's the best.
Have you had the pineapple?
On the planet.
Haven't had the pineapple.
What?
Yes.
I don't even drink.
Well, he edged.
I was licking the bottle.
He topped Jay-Z and Drake.
Wow.
What about Dre? No way, huh?
He topped Dre.
This year. Really?
They said Dre
is that possible?
Dre is like numbered. I mean, he's lower down on the list. I think Nicki Minaj beat Dre.
Really?
Well, she do have a her Moscato's pretty good.
Is they say good? Other hip hop moguls in the top 10.
It's got
all
a lot of ass
which,
on it though.
Tastes kind
of
fake.
Dre did make the top 10 though. Him and Eminem and Kanye West.
Wow. Where is Eminem getting money from? I mean, does he have
residuals?
Just that though? I mean, because everybody else has lines. Does he have anything? I'm just curious. What does he have?
Maybe our next guest can.
He got white people.
Elaborate.
Oh, yeah, I guess he can talk
it.
About it. Yeah, yeah.
He got white people.
Yeah, true that.
He got white people money.
He got privilege.
Money. Yeah, privilege money.
Mm-hmm.
He got that money.
All right, so that's it for the POTUS report. Y'all are so lame.
I know, I'm trying to help them out, but.
Yeah, whatever.
Let's take a quick break so we can bring on our next guest. Sure. We'll get some music together.
I have my music, but can I ask a question?
Sure. Because
he brought up the thing about women wanting to get hit. Now, I did have a girl, high yellow girl. I don't know what it is about high yellow girls. They like to.
Yeah.
And she said, I want you to hit me while we didn't have sex. I'm like, I don't hit women.
She's slapping the ass.
No, she said she wanted hit. So I was like.
Like the face?
Yeah.
So, hit
so
my
I,
face.
I said, okay, I can oblige. Let's do this. So I'm hitting.
It's with an open hand.
I'm fucking. So I give a nice little, you know. And she said, harder. I was like. And then she said, harder. And I said, bow. She said, put your dick in. I can't do both. I can't go. I'm going to punch you. I'm going to fuck you. I can't fuck you.
Knock you out. Are we fighting the fucking?
Yeah, because I have to fuck you first, and then I can punch you.
Why you got on boxing gloves?
So I can't. Portis, you like to be?
What? Choked. She likes to be choked a little bit.
You like to be choked.
I can see.
We got her. We finally got her.
No.
Where do you think you got me at?
Just
considering
you took your
it. You didn't
time,
give us a
man.
Quick no.
Usually you go, shut the fuck up, Speedy. Or you say, fat
Speedy,
fuck.
I will not give you any information for you to fantasize about.
It's
that's
too late.
What you
I'm
do.
There. He's I like am this. Choking and grabbing your titties right now. I got two hands. One's around your throat and one is around the nipple.
Mind rape. I've already fucked
you. I don't think my guest is too amused.
I know. Well,
he loves them.
Anyway, it's the all-new Rollout Show. We're going to take a quick break and we'll be right back.